Good morning, everyone, to those who are presented in person in the lecture room and those who are watching us online. It's my pleasure this morning to introduce Mark Thomas, who received his bachelor's degree in 2006 and his PhD in computer science in 2010, both from Imperial College in London. And this morning he's going to talk about microphone array signal processing beyond the beamformer. Without further ado, Mark, you have the floor.
Thank you, Ivan. Okay, so yes, thank you for your kind introduction, Ivan. My name is Mark Thomas, and I'm currently a postdoctoral researcher at the Communications and Signal Processing Department at Imperial College London. And I'd like to thank you for coming to my talk entitled Microphone Array Signal Processing Beyond the Beamformer. I'd like to welcome any questions throughout the talk, so feel free to interrupt me at any point. So, array signal processing has been around for quite some time. In the 50s, there was quite a lot of research into phased antenna arrays for steering a beam. But it's only relatively recently that we've started seeing multiple microphones in consumer devices. And I'm sure I don't need to point out the round table device and the Kinect device. There are now spherical microphone arrays, including the EigenMic and the 64-channel VisiSonics array. Imperial College has developed a number of planar and linear microphone arrays for research purposes. And the motivation behind these is beamforming, which is a very powerful technique for spatial filtering. But what I would like to talk about in this talk is other ways of using multi-microphone measurements. So the outline of my talk is that I will begin with an introduction showing the kind of application scenario that I would expect to be working in and talk about some of the notation. Now, beamforming is a method that makes some assumptions about the way waves propagate in space. What I would like to look at are some other kind of models that we could impose, and the main topic of this talk is multi-channel dereverberation. I would first like to talk about spatiotemporal averaging, which applies models of the voice. An equalization by channel shortening, which applies a channel model. The acoustic rake receiver, which applies a geometric model in addition to beamforming. And then in the second part, I'll talk about geometric inference. And what we mean by inference is the estimation of the position of line reflectors in two dimensions in an acoustic environment using acoustic measurements. I will then conclude at the very end. So the application scenario, as I'm sure is very familiar to many of you, is that we have an acoustic enclosure, and inside this enclosure there's a talker at some point in space. Somewhere else is a microphone or an array of microphones, and this will receive the wanted direct pass signal. Slightly after that will be early reflections from hard surfaces like walls and tables. A bit later on are the late reflection caused by the higher order reflections, or the reverberant tail as it's sometimes referred to. And there will also be some additive noise. And this could be from acoustic noise sources like an unwanted talker or some other noises within a room in a domestic environment. You'd expect to hear clattering and people walking around. And there's also the problem of additive noise coming from the measurement apparatus. This might be within the microphone or within some coding that goes along, and all of this adds to the observed signal at the microphone. So, put a bit more formally, we can say that a speech signal, S of N, is convolved using a filtering matrix H. This then produces an observation Y. Added to this is a noise signal B to then produce an observation X. Now, what we can do with this X is perhaps apply a beamformer, and the purpose of this is to try to point a lobe of sensitivity that attenuates the unwanted talkers that are spatially distributed elsewhere. Another class of dereverberation and noise reduction, of which beamforming is part, will also aim to estimate the speech signal, but perhaps by some different means. And this I'll talk about a little bit later in the dereverberation part of the talk. Geometric inference aims to estimate the parameters L, which are parameters for the line reflectors in the space. And I've also added at the bottom blind channel identification. Now, although I don't talk about this explicitly in this talk, it's nevertheless been a part of my research as a postdoctoral researcher. And without multi-channel observations and the spatial diversity that it produces, blind channel identification can't be achieved. The other thing that I would like to say in the introduction is some notation that I'll use. The channel is always denoted by M and its length is L. And the observation at channel X, channel M is XM of N. And what is often done, and I will be doing in this talk, is to remove the channel independence and stack all of the channels into one vector. So if there's no subscript, then it can be assumed to be a multi-channel observation. So I'd like to now move on to the first dereverberation algorithm, which is called spatiotemporal averaging. And this relies on voice modeling. So I'd like to begin by looking at the source filter model of speech. And what this says is that air passing from the lungs passes through the glottis. And as it does so, it causes the glottis to vibrate periodically. And these excitations are then filtered by the pharyngeal, oral, and nasal cavities to produce sounds that we interpret as voiced phonemes. What we often do is lump the transfer function of the pharyngeal, oral, and nasal cavities into one function called the vocal tract. And this, in the Z domain, is represented by V of Z, and is often modelled as a pth order AR process. This is excited by the excitation signal, or sometimes called the error signal, from the glossis, E of Z, such that the signal that's produced, S of Z, is the product of V of Z and E of Z. And the motivation for separating this out is very, very common in the case of coding, where it's possible to achieve a very efficient coding by taking the V of Z and the E of Z, parameterizing them differently, and then recombining them again at the receiver. And it's possible to estimate these transfer functions and the excitation signal blindly using linear predictive coding. What this does is try to minimize the square error between the speech signal and the predicted speech signal using the prediction weights A. And these A's are found by solving this Wiener solution involving an autocorrelation matrix capital R and a cross-correlation vector lowercase r. And as I said, this is very common in the field of coding and works very well for single-channel speech, providing that there's no reverberation. But what then happens if we have multiple observations in a reverberant environment? Well, we have two options. We could try to find a multi-channel solution to the problem, or perhaps more straightforwardly, we could take a single-channel linear predictive coding and apply it to the output of a beamformer. Now, let's say we take on the former case. We can come up with these autocorrelation matrices and cross-correlation vectors for every channel M in turn, and then average them to form a more robust estimate, R hat and lowercase r hat. Using these two, we can then find the optimal coefficients, B hat opt. And with some analysis, it can be shown that by spatial expectation that the B hat opt is a unbiased estimator of A opt. Now, if instead we were to opt for the second case, where we take the single channel LPC and apply it to the output of a beamformer, it can be shown analytically that these coefficients are no longer an unbiased estimate of the A opt for the clean speech. So this is a fairly straightforward example to show that it can sometimes be a bit better to come up with a dedicated multi-channel algorithm as opposed to taking a single-channel algorithm and applying it to the output of a beamformer. So let's take a look at the...
Get that output solution actually by cranking through the minimum squared error on...
Yeah, so...
Okay, so that truly is the Wiener optimal solution. It is truly the optimal solution.
Yeah, it is truly the optimal solution, but only by spatial expectation. So the effect of reverberation will, of course, add some error. But if you were to find the expectation at every point in the space, then it provides an unbiased estimator. So this analysis was done by Galbich, Ward, and Naylor in a paper in JASA in 2006. So the algorithm that I'd like to look at is called spatiotemporal averaging. So as we've seen, at microphone M, the output is given by XM of N. And we've seen already that we can estimate these optimal coefficients B. Now, what we also have is to try to estimate an enhanced linear prediction residual that then, when resynthesized, gives us a more accurate estimate of the speech signal. And the motivation for this is as follows. On the top left here, we have the clean speech signal, which shows this nice periodic nature and these extra wiggles due to the spectral shaping by the vocal tract. Beneath it is the clean linear prediction residual, and this is the features that we see are these periodic impulsive events caused by the rapid closure of the glosses, so it sort of snaps together like a hand clap. On the top right is the reverberant speech, which we can still see some of this periodic nature in it, but there's some additional noise caused by the presence of reverberation. But if we then look beneath this, we see that the residual has been masked very heavily by noise, and it's not really possible to pick out any impulsive features. And it's been shown in previous works that in the presence of reverberation, the effect is to have a lot more distortion placed into the residual than it is to be placed onto the AR coefficients. So given that we know that the reverberant residual is so badly corrupted by the reverberation, we want to do as much as we can to try to fix this. So let's just look at a system diagram of what we've done so far. The speech signal passes through the acoustic impulse responses, which then produces these microphone observations. We then applied the multi-channel LPC coefficients to give these optimal coefficients B. So the next thing is to apply some spatial averaging. And we do this with a delay and sum beamformer. And the aim is to take the output from the delay and sum beamformer, which turns a multi-channel observation into a single channel, and then find a residual by inverse filtering the output of the beamformer with these coefficients B. So the idea of a delay and sum beamformer is to coherently sum the observations in such a way that these delays tau allow that the coherent sum of the wanted signal, which is the speech, the direct path, causing the attenuation of the unwanted terms. And there are various ways of estimating this tau that I won't go into any detail about here. And as I said on the previous slide, the aim is to then take this output, X bar of N, inverse filter it with these multi-channel LPC coefficients B hat to produce a prediction residual E bar. And the way we enhance this is then to exploit the pseudo-periodicity of the voice speech. A few slides ago, we saw that the speech signal is very periodic, and therefore we can expect that any features due to the voice source, or this excitation signal, is going to be common from one cycle to the next. And if we then perform an intercycle averaging, we should be able to boost those features that are caused by the voice source in the glosses and attenuate all those terms caused by the reverberation. So we call this larynx cycle temporal averaging, which is applied to this DSB residual. So the way we do it is we consider a weighted temporal averaging of two I neighbouring cycles. So we take a cycle and then we take I neighbouring cycles either side of it. And I is typically in the range 2 or 3. The signal is segmented into individual glottal cycles by finding the glottal closure instance and using these to delimit the one cycle to the next. And then by performing this temporal averaging, it's possible to attenuate those unwanted terms. But a problem arises in that we don't know where these glottal closure instances occur. Now, this is a bit of a problem. And this is where the idea of multi-channel DIPSA comes from. Now, DIPSA is an algorithm that was developed by Imperial College shortly before I arrived. And it's a method for taking a single channel piece of speech and estimating the glottal closure instance, those periodic impulses within the LPC residual. And it does this by first calculating the LP residual and then using a technique called the phase slope function. And this is essentially a measure of energy calculated over a sliding window. And the features that we find with the phase slope function is that the positive going zero crossings locate the positions of impulsive features within the signal. We'll see a bit more of this on the next slide. Once we've located these features, there will be a candidate set. And within that set are the true GCIs that we want, but there will be a lot of additional incorrect estimates that need to be removed. And we do this by applying a dynamic programming algorithm that I'll explain in a couple of slides' time. So just to give an example of what I'm talking about here, on the top is a speech signal, which shows this clear periodic nature. Underneath it is the linear prediction residual, showing these impulsive features and a few bits of noise in between. And the aim is to locate these impulsive events. Now, if we look at the phase slope function at the bottom, we see that the positive going zero crossings of this function identify the location of the true GCIs. What sometimes happens is a GCI is missed, as is shown here, due to some additional random noise in the residual. And we have techniques to deal with this. We call it phase slope projection. Yes, question please?
Forget it, you're whispering.
I will discuss this later, yes. So the question there is that there are modes of speech, fricatives, whispering, non-voiced, unvoiced, where there is no such periodicity. And I'll talk very briefly about how we deal with this. Please, yeah?
So I want to ask a question a little bit about the nature of the distortion that's happening from the reverberation. So it seemed like when you showed the earlier pictures, and that I'm guessing is also happening from the very noisy residual that you showed that happened under reverberant speech, is mm-hmm. that, you know, essentially, you know, if you think about the waveform, it's like pieces are being moved around a little bit because, you know, reflections from the baseline, because reflections are coming in and affecting the magnitude, you're basically seeing that, like, what looks like the start of the period is kind of moved over a little bit over here and moved over a little bit over there. And I guess what I'm wondering is that if you now apply this type of analysis, you know, to look at where the period's actually starting, you're not going to have, like, a super uniform
absolutely
period. There's going to be a little bit
yeah.
of...
Yeah. I don't know if that was picked up by the microphone, but the question was that when we add reverberation, the linear prediction residual is spoilt, and as well as having these wanted peaks, we get lots of unwanted peaks, and it then becomes very ambiguous as to where these occur. So right now I'm talking about the single channel Dipser algorithm. I'll then talk about the multi-channel algorithm that tries to deal with this problem. Yeah. So what we're seeing here is the clean case. There's no reverberation. Any errors here are due to framing errors, and there may be some additional aspiration noise in here that will manifest itself in the residual. So yes, we'll talk about what we do in the reverberant case in just a minute. But yeah, so the reverberant case is a particular problem, especially when we consider it the erroneous zero crossing. Right now in the clean case, this will happen every now and then, and we don't know right now what zero crossing is due to the true GCI and what is due to the erroneous GCI. So we need to apply an algorithm that tries to get rid of these unwanted signals, unwanted zero crossings. And what Dipser does is apply a dynamic programming algorithm that finds a series of costs for each of the candidates in turn. And for each cost, some things like waveform similarity and pitch deviation are found. And it's expected that because of the pseudo-periodicity of voiced speech, the pitch deviation would be very low, it would happen very regularly, and that the waveform similarity from one cycle to the next should also be very similar. So we make a cost that should be low for these terms, so they should be a low cost. And the dynamic programming then finds a path through all of the candidates within some region of support that minimizes this cost function using some additional weights. And it just so happens that these two, speech waveform similarity and pitch deviation, are the most important, and this has been found with training data. So, providing we have clean speech, the single-channel Dipser algorithm works very well, and usually it will produce about 96% identification accuracy. This actually formed quite a large topic within my PhD, and there are lots of new algorithms that have superseded Dipser that get much more accurate estimates of the glottal closure, but we'll stick with Dipser for now. So, going back to your question, a problem arises when we have reverberation. And it's a particular problem because the reverberation produces all sorts of nasty spurious peaks in the LPC residual. So in much the same way as with multi-channel LPC, we have two options. We could take DIPSA and apply it to the output of a beamformer, or we could extend the algorithm in some way to make a multi-channel variant of it. Now let's say we do the latter. One thing we could do is try to generate a series of candidates for every channel in turn. Now we know that there are going to be lots of additional spurious zero crossings due to the reverberation, but due to the spatial diversity, we should expect that only the wanted signal is the one that contains all of those candidates that show some kind of coherence across channels. So we augment the cost vector to the dynamic programming algorithm that measures the interchannel correlation between the candidates. And it then penalizes those with low interchannel correlation and encourages those with high interchannel correlation. So we have a separate candidate generator for every channel in turn. And we had a paper at USIPCO, the USIPCO conference in 2007 about this. So if we look at what happens when we apply reverberation, in the clean case with a large database of speech, we get about a 96% identification accuracy. And identification accuracy is defined as the number of correct identifications divided by the total number of cycles within the voiced speech. The ground truth for this algorithm was done with synchronous EGG recordings. So an EGG is the electroglottograph. This involves placing a pair of electrodes either side of the glottis, and a recording was then made with a head held at a specific distance from the microphone and then time aligned. And it's much more straightforward to pick out the glottal closure instance from this signal because it doesn't contain any measurement noise from acoustic noise sources. It doesn't have any filtering by the vocal tract, so we don't have any errors in removing the resonances. And this too was actually quite a large part of my PhD, and I've published quite a few papers on GCI and GOI, the opening instant detection from voice speech.
Like you said, EGG?
The EGG, the electroglottograph. Or electroglottogram.
You have two electrodes, what you get? The muscular activity?
Well, it's a measure of the conductance. So there's across the electrodes is an RF source of about 1 megahertz.
It's a variation and of electroplethysmography.
It's
electroplethysmography is measuring the conductance of a human flesh.
The conductance. And the reason why this changes is that if we're measuring the cross section of the glottis, it sort of takes this zipper-like fashion. And as it comes close together, then there's a lot more, lot higher conductance and a lot less. If anyone's interested about this later on, then I can show some examples and how we deal with it. So back to the performance. We've got this ground truth that we form with the EGG estimate. In the clean case, we do about 96% accuracy. If we then apply the single channel algorithm to the output of a beamformer, apply the single channel output algorithm to the one of the observations, we see that the identification accuracy drops very, very quickly. And if we observe as well the time alignment of each identification, that also gets worse, but I haven't shown an example here. So one of the possibilities was to take the single channel algorithm and apply it to the output of a beamformer. And this is shown in yellow, and not surprisingly, it does a bit better because the beamformer has helped to attenuate the reverberant components. If we then take the same data set and apply it to the multi-channel algorithm, it does better still. So we have another example of how sometimes it's better to come up with a multi-channel variant of an algorithm rather than taking the single-channel algorithm and applying it to the output of a beamformer. Another plug for a paper has just been accepted on a number of different algorithms for glottal closure detection from speech signals in lots of different noise and reverberation environments. So that was a bit of a sideline on DIPSA. Now let's get back to the spatiotemporal averaging. We have everything we need. We've got our observations. We have an algorithm that finds an optimal set of LP coefficients to give us a residual. We apply that to a delay in some beamformer to get a DSB residual. We now know where the glottal closure instance occur and are able to perform this larynx synchronous temporal averaging. And then this gives us the following. On the top is the clean residual showing this nice P periodic train of impulses. In the middle is the reverberant residual, which is not quite as bad in this case as we saw earlier. There are some peaks in there, but some of them are buried in noise. But then, having performed the spatiotemporal averaging, we get this enhanced residual, which looks much more like the residual in the clean case.
Question about the state vector of your dynamic programming algorithm. Mm-hmm. Is it just the location of the glottal closures, or is it like the entire vector of the period? Like, what's the actual internal state?
The internal state is based on the absolute timing of the GCI.
You end up with is a set of timings.
Yeah. So we have a set of time instance, yeah. And as you pass through time, the instance of glottal closure from the candidates are found, and with this is associated those six cost vectors. So the vector of six cost elements, and then it may jump some candidates that are incorrect, and then find this path that within some region of support maximizes the likelihood and therefore minimizes the costs. There is a trade-off. If you were to take lots and lots of cycles, it becomes quite computationally intractable, and it comes to a point where there are too many different possible paths to choose. What can also happen is if you take lots and lots of cycles, the pitch period will start changing slightly, and if it's different at one end to the other, then the pitch consistency cost is not going to give you a reliable estimate. So there is this trade-off. If you make it too short, then there comes a point when you're not benefiting from these similarity features. So
aren't things like your pitch consistency cost, though, from frame to frame? Like, presumably, like, you know, standard DB setup, you know, you have all these candidates at each mm-hmm. time step, and then you have the transition costs between them. So the pitch transition cost would be one that from one state to the next, it would increase or decrease based on whether they were consistent or not, right? But if it moved, changed slowly through a long period, that shouldn't be so bad, should it?
I'm trying to think how we achieve this. So the question is that if we take lots and lots of cycles, then the pitch consistency will change slowly, and that it shouldn't matter from one end to the next. Now, yeah, I actually forget how we approach this. I forget whether it's done on a per cycle basis or whether it's the pitch period as the variation of the pitch period compared with the overall pitch period. If it's the latter case, which I think it might be, then there's a problem because you will start seeing more deviation. But maybe we can talk about this later. Yeah.
You're doing some sort of larynx center filtering, but these are not exactly the same. So how do you get from reverberant residual to enhanced residual?
So the reverberant residual first passes through the spatial filtering with the beamformer, and that will then help to enhance these ever so slightly. The larynx cycle temporal averaging is weighted using a Tukey window. So what this does is prevent it from forming any averaging at the glottal closure instant, or it's weighted in such a way that there's less averaging at the GCI, but there's lots more averaging happening between them. And that's, if I go back a few slides.
You essentially designed a sort of on the fly a filter that has sort of it's a spike at the frequency of the glottal index, and then is a stop band everywhere else as much as you could. And then you apply it at the right phase to the...
Yeah, we don't think of it so much in the frequency domain. This is all a time domain averaging, so there's no sort of pass band and stop band at this point. But yeah, it's effectively a linear filter. So yes, you could look at it in those terms. Actually, this brings us very neatly onto what happens in the case of unvoiced speech. So thank you for pointing that out. So if I just go back to where we were... Yeah. So we have the enhanced residual. So this has dealt with what happens in the case of voice speech. Now, there are times in speech that don't have any kind of periodicity, no anything unvoiced, fricatives and such forth, and indeed silence, don't have this periodicity. So we don't really want to apply this temporal averaging during these periods. The spatial averaging is okay, but not so much the temporal averaging. So that brings on the very last part of this that involves a voiced, unvoiced, and silenced classification. Now, I didn't actually put any slides on this, but the idea is that we only perform the larynx cycle temporal averaging during the voiced speech. And at the same time, we make an adaptive filter, which we call G, which looks at the difference between the output of the DSB and the enhanced residual, and then forms a filter that effectively achieves the same as the larynx cycle temporal averaging. This is updated during voiced speech, and it's done slowly on every cycle. And then during unvoiced speech, this filter is then applied instead of the temporal averaging. So this helps to give a little bit more robustness during the unvoiced speech. Although I don't have any slides on this, if we have some time afterwards, I can walk through the way in which we form this adaptive filter.
So you're doing an adaptive filter, trying to guess what the larynx cycle temporal averaging is attempting to do.
Precisely.
In time, in space, both?
Well,
is
both.
One channel?
Yeah. So, well, it's actually in time because it's driven by the output of the DSB. So it's doing the same thing that the temporal averaging is doing, but not by temporal averaging, but instead by an adaptive filter. So it's a convoluted process that mimics it. Unfortunately, I don't have any information on this at the moment, but perhaps if we get some time at the end, I can exit this and we can look a little bit closer at the approach that we use. Yeah? But let's say that this works. We have then found an enhanced residual E hat of N. We can then resynthesize the speech using these multi-channel LP coefficients to give an estimated speech signal S hat of N. And we evaluated this by taking a real room with a T60 of about 300 milliseconds. We placed an 8 microphone linear array with a 5 centimeter spacing between the elements and varied the source array distance from 0.5 meter to 2 meters. The performance was then measured using the segmental SNR, which is a means of estimating the SNR on a frame-based approach, and the Bach spectral distortion score. With the segmental SNR, higher is better. With the spectral distortion, lower is better. And what we see is that if we look at one of the observed channels, in this case channel 1, we get the worst segmental SNR and the worst Bach spectral distortion. A bit better than that is the delay in some beamformer, which is forming a spatial averaging only. And then better than that is then the spatiotemporal averaging, which is doing both the spatial averaging of the beamformer and the temporal averaging of the larynx cycle averaging. So I'd like to play some example sounds that were recorded. So the first is the output of microphone 1.
George made the girl measure a good blue vase.
It always cuts off at that point. Do it again.
George made the girl measure a good blue vase.
And then the output from the delay in some beamformer.
George made the girl measure a good blue vase.
So perceptually it sounds like the microphone is closer, but there's still some evidence of the reverberant tail in the background. If we then apply the spatiotemporal averaging.
George made the girl measure a good blue vase.
Hopefully it should sound like the components of reverberation have been reduced, but we're in a fairly reverberant room here, and I think maybe to appreciate this properly you need to listen on headphones. Yeah, please. Yeah.
What is the distance between the speaker and the microphones in the examples?
In this example it's 2 meters. Yeah.
George made the girl measure a good blue vase. George made the girl measure a good blue vase.
So it's done its job. There are some artifacts. This is a fairly good example. Maybe if we have time at the end, I can play some bad examples where what tends to go wrong is the glottal closure instants are identified incorrectly, and then the wrong amount of temporal averaging is applied, and that then produces some musical noise. So I would like to summarise this section by saying that multi-channel LPC decomposes a reverberant speech signal into an excitation signal and a vocal tract filter, and that reverberation has a very significant effect upon the LP residual. Multi-channel DIPSA then segments the LP residual into glottal cycles, allowing us to perform an enhanced LP residual estimated by this technique called spatiotemporal averaging. The speech is then resynthesized with the LP coefficients, which is what we just heard. And the result of this is that the dereverberation performance of the spatiotemporal averaging is better than performing the spatial averaging alone. And there was a paper that we published on this at WASPA in 2007. Yes, please.
It seems like you're using a lot of knowledge of the sort of speech signal to, and it's particularly what happens to excitation, to do dereverberation. And then to do that, you sort of have to do a lot of the speech production analysis stuff. So there's some other techniques where they take the same basic approach, but it's a little bit more empirical. It's more just a question of changing objective function. Like, for example, they say, you know, oh, we basically want to come up with some adaptive filter so that the residual is peakier than it is before. Yeah. So like maximizing kurtosis or minimizing how Gaussian it is. So do you have any sense how, you know, obviously anything compared to the design, some beamformers can look very good. So do you have any sense, do you get something out of the fact that you're exploiting more from the speech knowledge, or how this would compare to things like that?
The question is that we, at the moment, exploit the speech signal, and we know lots of things about how the periodicity of the speech signal varies over time, and that there are other techniques that do things like maximizing the kurtosis of the LP residual. Now, although we've not made any direct comparisons between them, what we have done in the past is use the costs of DIPSA to give us an estimation of the reliability of the voicing. And rather than applying this technique exclusively to those periods in which we've found GCIs, we apply it only to those periods where we're pretty confident we can find it. Then, during those times when we aren't confident in the GCIs, then we want to apply something else. And that something else could include something like kurtosis maximization and such forth. So, yeah, I think there are lots of interesting extensions that could be done here based on how reliable the estimation of voicing is, and using alternative techniques to try to make this robust. That's about all I can say on that. But thank you for the question. It's a good question. Okay, so moving on. The next algorithm that I'd like to talk about is very different, and this uses not voice modelling but channel modelling. And I would like to talk specifically about an approach called channel shortening, which is quite popular in the field of RF, but not so common in the field of acoustics. Now, the aim of acoustic channel equalization is to use the estimate of the acoustic system H and remove it by some means. Unfortunately, although there are some existing optimal techniques, the effect of noise and estimation error in this finding this H has a very significant effect upon the quality of the equalized signal, and it really then limits its how applicable it is to the real world scenario. But what I would like to talk about here is a technique that we've been working on called channel shortening, and see how this helps to increase the robustness. So let's jump straight into a system diagram. This is very similar to the previous case, where we have a speech signal that passes through this convoluted process H with some noise to produce the observations X. And the aim is to find some filters G that, when convolved with the observations and then summed over all channels, produces an estimate of the speech signal. And we find these G's using an equalization algorithm, and this is driven by a system identification algorithm that aims to estimate these signals, these impulse responses H. So we can formulate the problem as taking a channel H and convolving it with an equalizer G that, when summed over all channels, produces a target function. And this target function is usually an impulse or a delayed impulse, where there's just one non-zero tap. This can be represented in matrix form, where we have a filtering matrix H and the coefficients G that we want to find, that then produce this desired response D. And the ultimate aim is to use these filters to form a filtering matrix, a convoluted matrix, that when applied to the observations gives us an estimate of the speech signal. Now, one way of doing this is to use the MINT algorithm, the multi-channel input-output inverse theorem. And this can be formulated as a multi-channel least squares problem that aims to minimize the difference between the equalized response and the desired response. And this can be found fairly straightforwardly using the Moore Penrose pseudo-inverse or some other kind of pseudo-inverse of the filtering matrix multiplied by the desired signal. This then gives us the G hat. And this can provide exact solutions. It can give an exact inverse, providing there are no common zeros in the acoustic impulse response's H. So if we were to take the impulse response from the source to one of the microphones, factorize it, no two zeros should be in common with them. This, if there are common zeros, then this produces an ambiguity because we don't know whether the received signal is due to the source or whether that zero is due to the acoustic impulse response. So it's important then that there are no common zeros. The other criterion is that we have to have at least two channels and the equalizer has to fulfill some length criterion. Now these all three are all possible. The problem comes in that the filters H used to estimate the inverse filters G must contain no errors. Now, for a practical scenario, this can't possibly be the case. There will always be some degree of error in the measurement apparatus or the system identification approach. So we could relax the problem. It may not be necessary to equalize the signal entirely to produce a delta function. What we could do is appeal to a branch of psychoacoustics that says that the ear cannot hear low-order reflections. So those low-order reflections from walls and tables and such forth are perceived not so much as a reverberation, but perhaps a colouring. And this has been shown subjectively not to be so detrimental to the intelligibility of the speech. So we have in the middle here a stylized diagram that shows the direct path impulse response, which is what we would really like to get at, the low-order reflections, which then combine into lots of high-order reflections that produce this reverberant tail. If we then make a weighting function that incorporates a relaxation window, as we call it, LR, we can say, OK, these low-order reflections, let's not bother to try to remove them. Let's just let the equalizer do whatever the hell it likes at that point and only try to attenuate the reverberant tail. And for this, we use an algorithm that we call the relaxed multi-channel least squares approach. And this involves a modified cost function that contains this weighting matrix W that has got zero entries within the relaxation window. And therefore, by finding the minimized square error solution, those taps are completely unconstrained. Now,
why you have the previous slide? Mm-hmm. Why you have once at the end? You care about the tail?
Yes.
So just that you want to get rid of the dependency on the middle part.
Indeed.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Then what's the head? I'm kind of confused.
Sorry, what's the problem, sir?
So what are the rows of the error function? Go back. You're smashing. You're saying that in terms of there's a column, there's an error. An error vector, it's a column, is hg minus d, h tilde g minus d is the error, right?
That's right.
So what does each row in that error vector, in that residual, represent?
That represents the magnitude, so the amplitude of any one of the resulting taps from the equalization. So g is a vector that is then convolved with h, forming, but using this convolution matrix H. And this then produces a vector, which is the response. So if you were to then apply this to a speech signal, ideally that would just be a delta function or a delayed delta function. So that all that you get out from the reverberant speech is the non-reverberant speech. So ideally we just want a delta.
So why do you have tolerance? Because it says, yes, I want a I want a impulse. Yes, I want zero. Yes, I want one. Yes, I want zero. I want zero. I want zero. I don't care. I don't care. I don't care. I don't care. I want zero. I want zero. I want zero. I want zero. Right. So why is it why is there tau? Why is tau not equal one?
Okay. So the reason why tau is not equal to one is because we are working with finite lengths of impulse response. Now let's say that we were to take the single channel case. It's not possible to form a complete inverse. It's only possible to form a least squares inverse. And if we have a finite number of taps, and that number of taps is in the order of the length of the channel, it forms some very tight constraints on the values of the taps. And the result is getting some very, very large taps that become far too large to be used for any kind of practical system. If we increase the length, say we were to increase the length of the equalizer to infinity, then the magnitude of those taps is no longer so great. So you're always forced by this length criterion. Now, one way of getting round this magnitude, this tap amplitude problem, is to find a target function that is not a delta, but a delayed delta. And this then relaxes the causality constraints. So let's say that we've got a direct pass signal and then a reflected signal. That reflected signal is always going to come later on. And what we really want to do is take that reflected signal and sort of time align it with the direct path. This implies some anti-causality. Now, if we have a target function that is a delta with no taps before it, that anti-causality can't happen. And the only way it can get round it is to use what little bit of information is in other taps to try to do whatever it can to get this target.
So it's really, I want zero, I want zero, I want zero, I want zero, I want one. Mm-hmm. I don't care, I don't care, I don't care, I don't care.
Precisely.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah, maybe I should have explained in a little bit more detail about what this tau is meant for. There was a paper actually recently by an author whom I forget, that looks at what happens with the filter gain. So this is the L2 norm of the filter, and looks at the gain as a function of this tau. And it shows that the robustness can be improved by increasing the tau, introducing this sort of non-causality problem. And by increasing this tau, we can reduce the gain and then make it more robust. This RMCLS algorithm does it in two ways. It can exploit the tau, but it can also exploit the fact that we don't care what these taps are, so it can then take whatever value it likes. And if we then take some Monte Carlo simulations, where we've just taken the room and made some random locations of source and receiver, and then look at the mean filter gain, we see that when there is no relaxation window at all, which is equivalent to the mint approach, the gains are massive. They can be in excess of 50 dB. And for such a large amount of gain, any tiny amount of noise or system error is going to manifest itself as a huge error in the output. So while this could work in very nicely in the no error, no noise environment, as soon as you come up with a practical scenario, this is not suitable. But by having this relaxation and allowing those taps within the relaxation window to take whatever value they like, the gain is significantly reduced. And even for a relaxation window of 50 milliseconds, perceptually, this is not actually too bad. But it allows us to reduce this gain a long, long way and therefore make it much more robust to a real-world deployment. I'll give you an example now of what happens when we introduce a little bit of error. So we simulated a room of 10 by 10 by 3 meters with a T60 of 600 milliseconds and placed two microphones within there. We forget about noise for now, but instead we add Gaussian errors to the channels H to yield a mismatch between H and the perturbed system of minus 40 dB. So it's just a very small amount of error. On the top left is the channel 1. And here we can just about make out these small taps due to the low order reflections. And this is then followed by the reverberant tail. The second is the equalized impulse response on the output of the mint algorithm. And although we can't see it here at the zeroth tap, so here tau is zero, there's a value of one or very close to it. and this is followed by lots of very small taps. So it's done what it should do is by suppressing those taps. In the third and fourth case are two examples of channel shortening, RMCLS and another algorithm that is based on maximizing the Rayleigh coefficient. I won't talk in any great detail about that now. But in both cases, the relaxation window has been set to 50 milliseconds. And we can see that these taps are taking any non-zero value they like, followed by a very much more attenuated tail. Now, if we then look at the energy decay curve, which is a measure of how the energy in the impulse response and in the last three cases, the equalized impulse response, we see that in blue is the decay of the first channel. The mint output is shown in red. Now, it's a bit deceptive because in B, it looks like there are lots of very small taps compared with the direct path. But actually, if you look at the energy decay curve, we see that it's actually increased the level of reverberation. So rather than performing dereverberation, it's just replaced it with another kind of reverberation. So it's failed in this case to achieve anything useful. And I'd like to remind you that this is actually with minus 40 dB error and no noise. So it's a really ideal scenario and still it's gone wrong. But if we then look at the RMCLS and other channel shortening approach, see that there's a rapid decay within the first 50 milliseconds, and after that point, the energy level is very much below that of the original channel. So in this case, the channel shortening approaches have performed a dereverberation.
Allow a non-zero, was a tau equal to 1 for all mint?
Yes, in this case it's equal to 1. We mentioned this in a paper that I think I'll plug in a minute for the forthcoming WASPA conference that gives some more experimental results on this and looks at what happens when we take lots of different scenarios with varying SNR and varying system mismatch. And there are audio examples that I'm going to show in a minute.
This is basically synthetic data, right?
This is synthetic data at the moment, yeah. With the image method, yeah. But we can take the real-world scenario. So we took a real room of 5 by 3 by 3 meters with a T60 of just under 200 milliseconds. So this is like a typical office environment. We then performed a supervised system identification for two channels. This was done using the maximum length sequence approach. And it's using the same setups. We had a pair of microphones and a loudspeaker. Using the same setup as we did to estimate the impulse response, we then played some speech through the loudspeaker, recorded it with the microphones, and then attempted to use these algorithms to perform a dereverberation on the recorded signal. Now, there is always going to be some degree of error in the system identification because of noise and finite length errors and all other sort of things. There was also some amount of noise within the room due to the air ducting, and there were people there sort of shuffling around. And just as an additional objective measure, we used the PESC approach. So the PESC is an algorithm that gives an estimated predicted mean opinion score, just as a sort of rough and ready approach to give an objective measure as to how well this has worked. So I'd like to play the clean speech signal.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
And then the recorded signal.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
Unfortunately, once again, with this room being a bit reverberant, it's not very easy to tell. On headphones, you can tell the difference. But what should be noticeable is then when we take this approach and then apply it to the mint algorithm.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
So the reverberation has certainly increased. And if you listen on headphones, there's a lot more noise in the background. So it hasn't performed any kind of dereverberation. And I'll just play one more with a channel shortening of 12.5 milliseconds, which is pretty short. And this yields a perceptual MOS score of 3.1.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
And then if we compare that again with the recorded.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
So I hope. Yep, clean speech.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
So remind me again, so LR is the amount of the delay?
So LR is not delay. LR is the length of the relaxation window. It's the number of samples at the beginning of the target impulse response in which we say, take whatever value you like. Don't try to attenuate it to zero, just take it to whatever value. What happens is when you increase the LR a bit further, some degree of spectral distortion is introduced because the low order taps are then being included and the ear then perceives this as a spectral distortion. So maybe you'd like to listen to that as well.
Language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
And we missed the beginning. Let's play that again.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
And then compare that with the best case.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
There's a small spectral tilt there. There's a bit of high frequency information missing when we make the relaxation window too long.
The reverberation energy close to the first reflection.
And there are some more results in the forthcoming RASPR paper on this, and if anyone's interested, then we can talk about those a bit later.
So it's 12.5.
The optimal. In this case, it is the optimal. The optimal will vary depending on the room and the amount of mismatch in the system and the amount of noise. And the I think, can I show this slide? Ah, yes. So this was a hidden slide. This shows the case where we took a simulated room and performed some Monte Carlo simulations where we had a case that only considers noise and only considers channel error. And in the noise was varied between 10 dB SNR and an infinite SNR, and the channel error was change between minus 10 dB to minus infinity. So the minus infinity channel error is the best case. And I think we can just about make out here, on the bottom is the dashed line, and this dashed line is the unequalized response. And there are other dashed lines to show the equalized response, the unequalized response for the different noise scenarios. On the x-axis is the length of relaxation, and on the y-axis is the perceptual MOS score. And what we see is that provided the SNR is in excess of about 30 dB, which I think is about reasonable for an office environment, then you can benefit from introducing this channel shortening. If you do no channel shortening at all, then this drops very, very much, and most of the time you're actually below the dashed line, so there's no point in performing the MINT algorithm on these cases. Only in the case of no noise can the channel shortening the MINT algorithm produce the best score, and here is 4.5 is the highest score, which says that there is no error in equalized signal. Interestingly, on the right hand side is the case where we consider no channel error, and the dashed line is therefore in the same place all the time because there's no noise. We see that actually the algorithm is more sensitive to a certain number of dB of additive noise than it is to a certain number of dB of channel error. So while there are lots of papers that look at channel error, the real killer here is actually the amount of noise that's been added, not the channel error itself. And it also shows that in every case, if we introduce a small amount of channel shortening, then there is some empirical optimum length. And it seems to vary somewhere between 0 and 20 milliseconds. So on the whole, I think in every case, if you pick a channel shortening length of about 10 milliseconds, then that's in the area of the sort of empirical optimum. But some more analysis needs to be done on this to find an analytical expression as to the expected performance as a function of noise, as a function of channel error, and a function of the shortening length. So if there are no further questions on this section, I would like to summarise by saying that perfect dereverberation can be achieved by the MINT algorithm, provided the channel is known with no error and provided there's no noise. If we introduce an error or noise, then this is very detrimental to performance, and that we can approach the problem by using the channel shortening technique that appeals to psychoacoustics and says that the ear cannot distinguish low-order reflections, and therefore we aim to equalize only the reverberant tail and to leave those low-order reflections alone. This achieves improved robustness because the gain is reduced, and it then allows it to be applied to real-world recordings. So, the final algorithm that I'd like to talk about in dereverberation applies geometric modelling in addition to the propagation modelling that is applied with beamforming. Now, in overview, the idea of a beamformer is to coherently sum, or maybe filter and sum, or sum and filter, the direct path of component of the multi-microphone observations. It's this direct path that we want to get at. But if we then consider the image model of a room, we can say that if there is this room which is in solid black, and then inside it is a receiver or an array of receivers by circle, and a source in green on the X, the reflections produce image sources outside the room. Now, in red here are the first order image sources. In this 2D case, there are four. If you take an extension to 3D, where we consider the floor and ceiling, there will be six first order reflections in this shoebox environment. There are also higher order reflections, where reflections have been reflected, and this produces image sources that are further away, and this produces the reverberant tail that we talked about in the previous section. So, if we can identify where these image sources are, is it then possible to use them to our advantage? Can we actually then perform some kind of coherent averaging of not just the direct path signal, but the signal from the low-order reflections? And this approach is called a Rake receiver. A Rake receiver is a technique used commonly in communications where reflections off hills and tall buildings are time-aligned and then coherently summed with the direct path signal. What we want to do here is apply the same approach but using acoustics. Now, this section's a little bit shorter because this is a preliminary investigation, so I won't go into quite so much detail. But the idea is that if we take this stylized image of a single channel, there's the large direct path tap, there are some small sparse taps caused by the low-order reflections and then followed by the reverberant tail. If we take the single channel and then align it with the first-order reflections and then sum, it should be then possible to reinforce the direct path with this sort of pseudo-direct path caused by the image sources. Now here we've shown the single-channel case, but it should then be possible to then take the multi-channel case and align the direct path and first-order taps for all of the channels. So let's just look at what a delay in sum beamformer does. In this case, we're looking at it in the frequency domain. The steering filters can be thought of as a complex exponential, including a term tau m, and this tau compensates for the propagation delay from source to microphone m. And there's some weights which just preserve some amplitude criterion. The response is given by the product and sum of the steering weights, which include this complex exponential, and the transfer function from the source to microphone M. And then when summed over all, we then get the transfer function of the delay and sum beamformer. And the idea of this complex exponential is to cancel the positive complex exponential that's caused by the delay in propagation, so that all we're left with then is not a delay, but just some amplitude term. But at the moment, these taus are a function of M alone. If we consider the Rake case, then we need to think about more sources, which we'll call lowercase r. And r, if we limit ourselves to the first order reflections, is the capital R is 7 because of one, there's one source within the room and then six image sources on the outside of the room. So tau then becomes a function of both R and M. And then the response is very similar, except it includes this additional term that sums over all channels and all sources. So it's natural then to ask what the expected performance of this Rake delay in sum beamformer is. Well, one means of doing this is to use the direct to reverberant ratio. And this is a measure of the ratio of the energy in the direct path to the energy in the reverberation. And this is very closely related to the directivity index, which is sometimes used in the context of beamforming. Now, it's fairly straightforward to find the direct path amplitude, as it can be used. We can use a 3D Green's function for this, where here we've replaced the taus with a distance d, and the omega with a wave number k, but the product kd is actually equal to the product of omega and tau. There's also a term for the reflection coefficient, which is 1 for the direct path signal and less than 1 for signals emanating from the image sources outside the room. There's a slight simplification in here that we're assuming that this beta is not frequency dependent, but in a real world scenario, there will be some frequency dependence on the reflected sources, but we don't consider this right now. For the reverberant component, it's a little bit more tricky, as we don't necessarily have an expression for the expected value of the reverberation. But what we can do is appeal to statistical room acoustics that allows us to find the expected value of the cross-correlation between one microphone and a neighbouring microphone. And this is a function of the area of the walls, the average absorption coefficient, and the spatial location of the receiver relative to another receiver. And now that we have this expression for the expected value of the cross-correlation, and we have an expression for the expected DRR, we can work this through, and then it comes up with this rather nasty-looking expression. But there is some validity in this, as has been shown with some experimental results. And what we did was take a room of 4 by 5 by 6.4 metres, simulated using the source image method, using a T60 of half a second. So it's quite a large reverberant room where the field is quite diffuse. And it's this diffuseness that the statistical room acoustics relies upon. Within the room, we placed a linear array of M microphones spaced by 20 centimetres, and then ran 20 Monte Carlo runs with a random source receiver configuration. And on the bottom here is the output from the theoretical case with that expression in the previous slide and the simulated direct to reverberant ratio using from the output of the beamformer. And it's plotted as a function of the number of microphones and the number of sources. And what this shows is that, unsurprisingly, as we increase the number of microphones, we improve the performance because we increase the amount of spatial diversity of the receiver. But also that, providing we have more than about 2 microphones, if we introduce additional sources, the output DRR improves also. So without any additional hardware, this Rake paradigm gives us almost for free, with the exception of some additional computational overhead, an improved DRR. So the output of the rake delay in some beamformer is shown here in the case for 6 microphones and 7 sources, where we see a very large tap caused by the coherent sum of the direct path and first order reflected sources, some anticausal taps due to the way in which the signals are aligned, and this reverberant distribution on the right hand side. Now this is really only a preliminary investigation, but it does show that there is some merit in performing this rake delay in some beamformer to at least the simulated environment. So that's all I would like to talk about really on the rake delay in some beamformer. And I would like to summarise by saying that reverberant environments can be modelled as a distribution of image sources, and that low order reflections form sparse impulses in the acoustic impulse response. What we can then do is perform a temporal alignment of the direct path and first order reflections to perform what we're calling an acoustic rake receiver. And this preliminary analysis reveals that improved dereverberation can be achieved compared with a conventional beamformer. But there's quite a lot of future work to be done. It would be nice to make an extension whereby we use some optimal beamforming as opposed to a straightforward delay in sum. And it needs to be evaluated against alternative approaches, such as the maximum SNR beamformer, which in some sense considers all reflections based on some estimate of the noise space. So I'd now like to move on to the last topic of the talk, which we call geometric inference. And this, like the rake receiver, applies some geometric modelling. Now, this falls into the category of acoustic scene reconstruction, which aims to estimate some parameters of the acoustic environment. And specifically, we want to know where the reflecting boundaries are based on the measurement of some acoustic measurements. And this has been shown to be useful for things such as source localization and wave field rendering. And the way we do this is we use a geometric approach based on the time of arrival of reflections. So if we look at the diagram on the left, we can see a source, RS, and some receivers, R1 through 3, and through the y-axis is a single reflector. Now, I'll limit myself to the 2D case for this discussion and just talk briefly about the extension to 3D at the end. But we can say that the time of arrival of the reflections is the composite time from the source to the reflector and the reflector to the receiver. And then looked at in the acoustic impulse response, the time of arrival is the absolute time at which the peak occurs, and the time difference of arrival is the difference between, for example, the first, the direct path signal in channel 1 and the direct path signal in channel 2. Now, estimating these two OAs is actually a bit of a problem. On the top left here is a supervised system identification of a real room. And this is a fairly ideal case. We had a good loudspeaker, a good microphone, low noise. But what we see is, rather than having a nice defined peak, a sync-like peak, as seen in the previous slide where we used the image method, we have lots of little peaks of some compact support caused by the impulse response of the measurement apparatus, and most of this was in the loudspeaker itself. And this produces an ambiguity as to where this time occurs. The problem gets even worse when we consider an acoustic impulse, such as a click. So here we've got a finger click. And this has got a slightly wider support, but lots of little peaks, and it becomes very ambiguous as to where these peaks actually occur. So it then becomes very difficult to pinpoint an exact time. So the way we approach this problem is to estimate the impulse response on the left with the supervised case and on the right with the click, and then identify the direct path signal. We then draw a window around the direct path, time reverse it, and then convolve it with the whole impulse response. And this is a matched filter approach. And the ultimate outcome of this is not to reduce the support, but instead give a nicely defined single peak that we can identify very well for the direct path and the first order reflections. And the same approach can be applied to the finger click case. So that's the first problem out of the way. The second problem is that usually we don't have exact synchronization between the stimulus and the recording. So we don't know exactly when the stimulus occurred. All we have is the time difference of arrival. But this is okay because we can use existing source localization algorithms based on the time difference of arrival that localizes the source relative to the array, and then making some assumptions on the speed of sound, we can estimate the time of arrival. So let's say we then have this time of arrival. What can we do with it? Well, a rather neat result occurs in that if we know the spatial location of the receiver relative to the source, and we know the time of arrival, then this parameterizes an ellipse. And we know, therefore, that somewhere tangential to the ellipse is the location of the reflector. If we then consider multiple observations where the array geometry is known, we can then form multiple ellipses and find the common tangent, and this common tangent corresponds to the location of the reflector. Now, the way we solve this analytically is to define a line in homogeneous coordinates, and it's this line that corresponds to the reflector. And this is characterized by the fact that if you then multiply this tuple with x, y, and 1, any point on the line is equal to 0. We can also define a conic with this matrix, and there are some constraints with defining ellipse and using this notation. And it can be proven that a line is tangential to the conic, providing that L transpose C adjoint L equals 0, where C adjoint is denoted L C star. So then considering all of the channels, we can form a cost function based on the square magnitude of this L transpose C star L. Unfortunately, solving this problem is a little bit tricky because it's a nonlinear least squares optimization problem. And if we apply iterative techniques, then it tends to become trapped in local minima. And only recently have we come up with a closed form solution by making some assumptions about the nature of the cost surface and taking slices through that cost. I won't go into detail now because we've not got much time left. The case of multiple reflectors is an additional problem because we've got all these TOAs and they then need to be grouped somehow to find an individual reflector because we've got these TOAs and we don't know which reflector it comes from. We have some techniques that don't give a global optimization because this is too big a problem and is also non-convex, but that's all I'll say about that now. But let's say we have a line L as a ground truth and we have an estimate of the line L hat. We could evaluate it by looking at the alignment error, which is just the normalized inner product between the line and its estimate. And this is proportional to the cosine of the angle between them. Alternatively, we can just find the absolute angle between them. This can be misleading somehow because any parallel lines in space will give a low alignment error, even if they're a long, long way from one another. So we have another error that we call the distance error, where we take the zeroth microphone and project it onto the line and project it onto the estimated line and look at the distance between them. So we performed some experimentation where we formed a room of dimensions between 3 and 5 and 4 and 6 meters using the image method. We placed 4 microphones and 1 source in random locations, and for each run of the Monte Carlo, we formed 5 seconds of observation with Gaussian noise. Noise was then added to the observations to generate an SNR between -5 and +40 dB. And so the first thing we did was then take these observations and try to estimate the channel blindly using the robust NMC FLMS algorithm, which is a frequency domain blind system identification. The time differences of arrival were then found by a group delay-based peak detector, much the same way as we used the group delay function to work out the location of GCIs in the first dereverberation algorithm. The source was then located relative to the array using the TDOAs, and then the proposed algorithm was applied to find all 4 walls within 200 runs. And the results are as follows. On the left is an example room where we have the location of the source, 4 receivers placed randomly in the room, and we can just about make out here the common tangent of the blue line, and the common tangent of the ellipses forming the blue line, the common tangent of the red ellipses causing the red line. So this is an example of where the algorithm has worked well. And then on the right here is a plot of the localization accuracy as a function of input SNR. And then by ranking the estimated locations, we can see that the best wall, even in the case of -5 dB, still does pretty well. And providing we have an SNR of greater than about 5 dB, we can estimate even the worst wall. And this is because the BSI algorithm is able to identify sparse taps very quickly. The amplitude of the sparse taps may not be identified very well, and the amplitude and the location of the tail may not be very good. But providing we can pick out the temporal time, the time of arrival from these sparse taps, this is enough to then perform the inference. What we can also see in this dashed line is the source error, so the localization of the source in meters, and providing the SNR is greater than about 0 dB, then it does okay.
Does it matter what frequency impulse is?
Well, the impulse is over all frequencies, up to the Nyquist.
So technically it's a wideband signal?
It's a wideband signal.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's wideband Gaussian noise that it was stimulated with.
So, that's interesting.
The blind system identification algorithm that we used, the robust NMC FLMS, has been applied to speech. Now, although we haven't applied it here, a speech signal can be used to identify the transfer function, the impulse response, up to a degree of error. And given that it's the location in time of the sparse low-order reflections can be found very quickly, it may be possible to perform inference on speech alone. There will inevitably be an increased error in the source localization, and so that would need to be looked at as well. And we have a paper actually in the upcoming WASPA conference that looks at what happens when we have errors in the source localization and how they propagate through to the errors in the location of the reflectors. So this was a simulated case. We took a real-world recording of a room of about 5 by 6 meters with a high ceiling and placed a linear microphone array in the corner made up of 4 microphones, as shown here. I think they were placed at 16-centimeter intervals. We placed an additional microphone just slightly outside the line on a plane, and the reason for this is to resolve the front-back ambiguity that's inherent with linear array processing. We placed a loudspeaker at one of 4 different locations and performed a supervised system identification using the maximum length sequence method. The ground truth is in the circle and the estimated is in an X. And I think actually the error is due in part to estimating where the speaker was, because if you've got a bit of tape, there's a finite region within the loudspeaker, and it's very difficult to know exactly where this equivalent point source comes from, because it's not a point source. But nevertheless, the algorithm was applied, and in green and blue are the estimated walls, and the walls pass through the origin on parallel to the axes. And this seems to have done its job quite well. And we can see for one of the measurements, the in blue shows the ellipses, and there's no ambiguity here because the array is pretty much tangential, that is pretty much normal to the wall. But in the case where the wall is parallel to the array, this front-back ambiguity comes in, and only one of the ellipses due to this 5th microphone in the middle allows us to disambiguate between the front and the back. But here it seems to have done its job. So I'd like to summarise this section by saying that localization of 2D reflectors can be achieved with a geometric approach, and that it can be applied in very low SNR environments and to real recordings. And this is an ongoing piece of work in the project that I'm working on at the moment. There is the question of robustness enhancement using the Huff transform, and we have a paper at the upcoming New Sitco conference on this. As I mentioned earlier, there's the error propagation analysis due to things like errors in localizing the source and temporal errors caused by finite frequency, sampling frequencies and such forth. There's also the problem of extension to 3D, where an ellipse is no longer the solution, but somewhere on an ellipsoid. And this makes it computationally much more demanding, but the theory actually falls in quite neatly from 2D to 3D. And also is the application in wavefield rendering. Now, I've not been involved with this myself, but within our project, we've used the knowledge of the knowledge of the array of sources in wavefield rendering relative to a reflector, and then used the image sources as part of the wavefield rendering. And this has been achieved using a real-world scenario. So I would now like to bring my talk to a conclusion, and I'd like to summarise by saying that there are many algorithms that use multi-channel observations that don't rely exclusively upon beamforming techniques, and that some multi-channel algorithms can outperform single-channel algorithms applied to the output of a beamformer. But beamforming remains an extremely important component of the algorithms discussed, and so we would like to think of these algorithms as complementary as opposed to a replacement for beamforming. The dereverberation algorithms that we've discussed exploit multiple channels by appealing not only to wave propagation modelling, but to voice modelling, to channel modelling, and to geometric modelling. And finally, that the estimation of room geometry from multi-channel observations can be achieved for practical environments, and this is useful in many areas of acoustic signal processing. That concludes my talk. I thank you for your attention, and I welcome any further questions.
Thank you, Mark. Maybe two questions. There were a lot of questions during your talk. So, colleagues, questions? Thank you again.
No further questions. Okay. Thank you very much.